welcome to the last bad influence of the series. Our main review is the long-awaited Lemmings 2 on the Amiga.
In the last of his reports from America, Z Wright builds his own virtual summer camp. We take a sneak preview at the latest in British VR. All this and a look at the games that are going to be out in the summer of 1993. How do we do it for the money?
But before all that scrotty rubbish, bargains. Now this is the last episode, so I've decided to sell the shed and its entire contents. Here we have an antique motherboard with inlaid chippery, 47p. What else have we got? We've got my old Firtling hat. I wondered where that had got to. I think I'll keep hold of that, yes. And here we have it's a cheat for Super Mario Kart on the SNES. It gives you 5 brand new courses in the single-player time trials or the two-player match race mode. All you have to do is, on the course select screen, make sure that your arrow is pointing towards the Mushroom Cup option. And then you press left, right, left, right, left, left, right, right, and hit A. Now the word Special Cup will appear. Move down to Special Cup, and you'll be able to select any of the 5 new courses. Here we go. Rainbow Road. Marvellous. And there it is. Ha! Now, I'm not asking for a pound, I'm not asking 50p, I'm not even going to be here next week. So what will you give me for this marvellous cheat? Maybe 25p? Or...
This is the Barcode Battler, the latest craze in Japan, which is apparently even outselling the Game Boy. Barcodes are those black and white stripes that you get on all sorts of products that let the till know what the price is. The aim of the game is, of course, to save the world. To do this, you can enlist the help of various wizards and warriors. For example, if I chose Jawbreaker, if I turn it around, you can see on the back, there's a barcode. And I can put this barcode into the barcode reader on the machine. And you can see it has allotted me 4,000 energy, 1,200 attack and 700 defence. Now, the barcode battler will come up with an enemy for me and give them a certain amount of points. And then it'll start a battle. And the aim of that is I've got to get the enemy's points down to 0, the energy points, and keep my energy points full. To help me, I've got all these cards, power-ups and special weapons and the like. Now, so far, so exciting. But the reason this is really popular is because you can cut out the barcodes on various groceries and use those to give you energy and warriors and the like. For example, this cornflakes barcode gives me 4,000 energy points.
Not to be outdone, you can now buy this in Japan. It's called the Barcode Boy. It's an add-on for your Game Boy and will cost about £45. But before you start saving up, I should tell you, there are no plans to release this outside Japan. This is the only one in the country at the moment. Not as popular as I might have thought, though, because, well, all the instructions are in Japanese and nobody here can figure out how to use it. Our main review this week is Lemmings 2 on the Amiga. The first Lemmings was that rarest of things, a totally original game, and made itself a very hard act to follow. Yes, I know there have been lots of other reviews for Lemmings 2, but you can safely ignore all of those except ours. Why? Well, all the other reviews were based on an early demo disc. Our reviewers were the first people to see the full game, and here's what they thought, starting with Amanda.
This game's a lot better than the original. You have 12 new tribes, and you have 42 extra skills. And this makes the game a lot more exciting. Before you start the game, it's important that you look around so that you know where you're going. The game's still the same and you've got to get the lemmings back to their home. And the music's really good because it actually goes with what the tribe is, like this tribe is Scottish and it's got Scottish music. This is fast forward where you can speed them up so that it doesn't take so long. I have now opted for a spinner, and he spins through the ground, but to do this you need to get a fan. And you point the fan in the direction where you want the lemming to go. The good thing about this lemmings is that they don't die when they drop a long way, they just get a bit dazzled. I've now put it on fast forward again. But there's something in my way, so I'm just going to have to bang that out of the way. I'm going to fast forward it again so that they go back home. If you preferred the original Lemmings, without the set dressing and the ethnic tunes, there's a classic tribe. This is like a level from Lemmings 1. You have the diggers and the climbers, but you still have the extras from Lemmings 2, like the fast forward. This is well worth buying, even if you have the original. It's a massive game, and I can't wait to get it.
I'd certainly buy this game, so I won't give it full marks. Despite all the new improved features, it's still basically the same game.
It's a must for puzzle fans.
And so the final scores for Lemmings 2, the boys gave it 4 out of 5, and the girls gave it full marks, 5 out of 5.
Ah, there you are, Fervus. Now, it's the end of the series, and you're going to have to go out into the world. And obviously, you'll be worried about your spots and pimples. Now, this is my alternative right-on homeopathic spot remedy. I made it by recycling some of the shed stuff, though. There we go. Just about right. You use 5 6800 chips, don't worry about peeling. Then salt, pepper, and porridge to taste. And any other bits and pieces that you find lying around. No. Right, and then you simmer gently on a low heat and smear casually on your spots. Like that. And leave for about 4 months, and your spots will completely heal up with no side effects. Which reminds me, this is a cheat for Echo, the spot-free dolphin on the Mega Drive. If you want to get to Big Blue, who lives about 3/4 of the way through the game, simply type in this password. A-R-N, kiss, kiss, R-E-T. And there you go. Oh dear. Too much porridge, I think.
It's that time again. Every year, American kids are sent off in droves to that great U.S. institution, summer camp. Even my home state of New York has 2,000 of them. Nobody escapes. Usually it means lots of character building outdoors and stuff. I mean, it's not my style. I'm from Queens, New York City. Please.
But this year, it's going to be different. I've come to Seattle in the beautiful Pacific Northwest of America, home of the world's one and only virtual reality summer camp.
And the structure this week that we'll do, seeing that you've chose virtual reality,
by the end of this week, we'll have built our very own world. No mosquitoes, no rope swings, and no half-cooked food.
Okay, well, let's get started.
This summer camp is run by the Human Interface Technology Lab, or HIT Lab, at the University of Washington. It was set up 3 years ago to find some practical uses for virtual reality. Since then, they've produced everything from virtual human bodies to virtual landscapes of the whole of Seattle. Meanwhile, back at the summer camp, we've decided that our perfect world is a peaceful rainforest. The first step is to plan the objects for the world on paper.
We should make that fish a movable object.
Yeah.
That'd be good. And what do you have, Z?
Well, I have just a waterfall.
Okay, yeah, and with the waterfall, we might try to do some change in color, see how that works out.
The next thing you do is put the drawings that were on paper into the computer. And right now, I'm working on my tree. Okay, let's see. Okay, tree stump. Up to now, everybody's been making their worlds on the flat screen of the Apple Macs. But this afternoon, we get to do the real VR bit. Using the lab's state-of-the-art virtual reality equipment to fly through and explore each other's worlds. To whet your appetite, this is one of the worlds that another group produced.
And a fish floating there in the middle, which I believe you can grab and bring out of the water and leave wherever you want.
So here I go in full immersion virtual reality. Okay, there goes the sun. Okay, and I'm going in fast mode here. Oh, let's go pick up the snake.
When I first went in, the graphics were a little fuzzy and I couldn't see that well, but after a while I got used to it.
The best virtual world I've ever been in is the shark world. And I liked it because it actually had some action in it, rather than just looking.
If I had to choose between virtual reality and real life, I'd probably choose real life, because you have more control over yourself.
So what are you doing next summer? You'll never guess where I'll be. I haven't finished building it yet.
Thank you, Z. We've heard tell there are plans afoot for a British virtual reality summer camp. We'll keep you posted on any developments. That should be next year. In the meantime, this is probably the only way that you'll experience VR on equipment like this. Virtual reality machines are becoming very popular in arcades at the moment. In fact, a brand new dedicated VR center called Virtual Quest opened last Thursday on Tower Hill in London. It's only the second place in the country where you can experience the full VR role-play game Legend Quest, The other centre in Nottingham is now a mecca for people who want to become elves, dwarves and pixies and battle their way through skeleton-filled dungeons. But we've got an exclusive sneak preview of a brand new game designed to run on this kit, being expertly demonstrated by my friend and colleague, Miss Violet Berlin. It's called Grid Warriors, and it should be out in the summer. Are you all right in there?
Yeah, doing very well, thank you. I've dealt with a few spiders so far.
And that's all, is it?
Yeah, so far.
Well, it's designed for two characters, this game. One is a big, nasty alien, and the other a cyborg warrior. And they stalk each other inside a huge space vessel. Oh, well, good shot, yes. The warrior's got to deactivate the ship's self-destruct mechanism and destroy the alien, and the alien's got to stop you all in 4 minutes. So, have you found the self-destruct mechanism?
No. Have you found the alien? No, look, I found my feet. Look, if I look down.
It's marvellous, Violet. The universe is safe in your hands. Well, if we can persuade her to come out of cyberspace, it's time now for this week's news and previews.
Last week's programme, when Nam gave you a cheat for Sonic 2, our phones went crazy with calls wanting to know what it was, because none of you had written it down. Well, as a special once-only offer, here it is again. Select the sound test and play the following sound test. Options 19, 65, 9 and 17. Now press start. When Sonic appears with tails and gives the thumbs up, hit start and A together twice. You'll get a screen showing all the levels to choose from.
And that cheat and another which not only makes Sonic supersonic but also gives him, would you believe, blonde hair, they're both in the Data Blast. Little Devil is a game still under development for the Amiga and PC. It doesn't have any sound on it yet. The Little Devil Mo has grown horns because of drinking magic water. The aim is to get out of the underworld and back to normal.
The SuperDeck Systems Adapter has just been unveiled. It's a converter that lets you play NES games on the SNES. And the full version will allow you to play American NES and SNES games as well, due out later this year.
And now for some more games reviews.
Flashback on the Mega Drive follows the story of a research scientist, Conrad B. Hart. He's been kidnapped by aliens, had his memory erased, and he's just escaped from a high-security hospital. Some days nothing goes right. Here's James.
This is a really hard game. The controls are really hard to get used to at first, but the graphics make up for that. When he walks along like that, it's just like the man from Uncle, and that roll. He's even got a recoil from the gun when he shoots it. I haven't got a gun at this point, and I'm being chased by this psycho robot thing. That little thing that came up in the corner tells me I've just stood above a gun, and I've picked it up there. He's asked for it now. You don't always have the things that you need when you're going through the game, and you have to pick them up. It's good like that, because it's like a thinking game and an action game also. This game gets full marks for visuals and effects. It'll last you for years.
This is fantastic. The animation is beautifully fluid. It does take a bit of getting into, but it's worth sticking with.
There's some really realistic effects here, but be warned, it's only for expert players.
And the scores for Flashback. The boys gave it 5 out of 5, but the girls weren't quite so impressed. They gave it 4 out of 5.
Next, we've got Parodius, a parody of the Gradius series. Get it? Never mind. Anyway, if you want a game to cheer you up on a wet Wednesday in Barnsley, this is a wacky shoot-em-up on the SNES. It's also due out on the NES and the Game Boy. Here's Lakesh.
The ideas in this game are totally weird. You get to choose from 4 different battleships, the most effective of which is the Twin B. He's probably the best for beginners as well. This, whatever it is, keeps on attacking me in various different ways. There's a good difficulty curve, and the game gets harder as it goes along. He's turning red now, so I should complete him very soon. And there he goes, completed the level. This game's okay, but after a little while, you'll soon get tired of it. It's not very addictive.
It's cute, unusual, and mad. Every level holds a surprise, and you never know what's coming next. It's brilliant.
This is fast, fun, and cartoony. It's a game you can get into straight away, and it looks fantastic.
And the scores for Parodius. The boys gave it an average score of 3 out of 5, but the girls were a bit more impressed and gave it 4 out of 5. Now, as this is the last programme in the current series, we thought it would be a good time to take a look at some of the games that are going to be out in the next few months. So we've been joined by members of our ace review panel, at least that's what they told me to say, to tell us what they think. First up, something called Bubsy. It's on the SNES and the Mega Drive, a cartoony platformer starring a bobcat with a love of yarn balls. That's the hype. What do we think?
Well, I think it's a very good game, and it's faster than Sonic. The idea is to collect yarn balls, and it's not very hard. but the challenge is to find all the secret hidden rooms.
Sounds like a good game. The next one is Body Blows, a new beat-em-up out on the Amiga. There are loads of characters, each with their own special moves. What did you think of this one?
I preferred Street Fighter. This seemed a lot more monotonous than Street Fighter, and Streets of Rage 2 was much better.
I think this has to be probably the best beat-em-up night. It will be released very soon.
Really? What are the special moves like?
Well, you can do various different special moves, which are activated very simply, and it's a really good idea and concept, and it plays very fast.
Well, still on the subject of fighters, another fighting game, Pit Fighter, which is on the links. Now, this is not just a boxing game, but a karate, a wrestling, and a bare-knuckle beat-em-up all rolled into one. Are you a beat-em-up fan, first of all?
I am, but this seems a very good game when you first play it. But there's only really the punch and the kick, and after a while, it gets really boring.
Next up, we've had loads of letters asking for us to look at games on the Master System. So here's a look at Mickey Mouse 2, the latest in the long line of Mickey Mouse romps. So, is this as good as the other Mickey games?
I don't think so. It was quite good, but I don't think it's as good as the other ones.
I think for the Master System, the graphics are excellent, and it puts a lot of gameplay in there as well. It's fun and enjoyable, and that's all you really need from a game.
Now, you've seen the toys, you've driven with Violet Berlin, and now experience the game Crash Dummies here on the Game Boy and due out on most systems too. First of all, because this is an odd concept, can you explain, Kes, what the Crash Dummies is actually you have to do?
Well, the idea is just to, like, die in the most spectacular way.
Splatter yourself into oblivion?
Yeah, that's the idea, like, crash into walls and fall from skyscrapers, bang into trees, anything possible.
Sounds like quite unusual gameplay. Does it work?
It's not bad. You've got different things on different levels, like you have a skiing level, which you have to crash into all the flags, and you have to drive a car and smash into a wall, and different things like that. It's brilliant.
Violet should be good at this game, then.
Definitely.
Oh, yeah, be a natural.
So that's it, then. The end. My last cheat. One final service I can perform, though. A lot of people wrote in asking for cheats for the Commodore 64, which is lucky, because it was the only thing that nobody wanted to buy. This letter from Kaylee Ratcliffe from Hemel Hempstead says, I wrote in to ask whether you'd talk more about the Commodore 64s because I need some cheats, fast. Right then, here are some cheats, fast. Ha, phew. And now a nice steady cheat. This is an Infinite Lives cheat for a game called Hudson Hawk. All you do on the title screen before the high score comes up is get your joystick and press it up, down, left, right, right, left, down, up. And that really is it. The end. Goodbye, Furtless. Keep your joysticks oiled and your keyboards dry. There's no business like show, business like no.
You know, for a moment then, I almost felt sorry for him. Now, before we go, the best computer and console games are often based on arcade versions. But this is a prototype of a new game out this summer, which was so popular on the Amiga, they're putting it into the arcades. You'll probably recognise it as Zool, a ninja of the nth dimension. And as you'll see, the character is bigger, faster, oh, and it's got new levels as well.
If you want to read the final, specially extended edition of the Data Blast, which includes not only the Sonic 2 cheat, but Namrud's special spot remedy, then set your video recording now. Last week's competition was to win a Menacer and a Mega Drive, and the question was, what does the word laser stand for?
And the answer is light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation.
Woohoo!
And we'll pick the winner from the sack. The lucky winner is... Here we go, big piece of paper. Oh, I can't read that. Adilu Omotayo from London. We'll be sending the prize off to you.
Sadly, this is the last Bad Influence in the current series, but you can still read about us in Bad Influence magazine, which is at your newsstand now. And as Nan would say, happy furtling.
We hope to be back in the autumn. See you then.
Bye-bye.